The Scott Townsend Show is a Deeds O'Man production.
Hey, this is Scott Townsend. Thanks for joining us. And today I've got with me a special guest, a good friend of mine, Jesse Anderson. How's it going, Jesse?
It's awesome. How are you, Scott? Good to see you.
Jesse is, let me get a little bit of a bio here on Jesse. So Jesse is a pastor's kid from Wisconsin. He's worked in the ministry since 16 years old and the last 11 years at Church on the Move. He's got a wonderful wife, Summer, and two awesome children, Nellie and Remy. And somehow or another, he got involved with Myers-Briggs and Clifton.
Yep.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, don't you love when that happens?
I always, and I'm just going to leave that in there because that's kind of funny. But anyway, Clifton, what is that?
Clifton Strengths. It used to be called Strengths Finder.
Strengths Finder, yeah. The book. Strengths Finder, yeah.
That's right, yep.
And so welcome to the show, Jesse. How are things going?
Thanks so much for having me. Well, I'm excited for today's conversation. It's been a full week. I'm not going to lie. I've kind of just been, I've been bouncing around a bunch of different things. Trying some new time management stuff this week. And so, but life is good.
You are a self-professed OCD type individual.
You know, I'm a recovering perfectionist and I'm wound a lot looser than I used to be. And that's just kind of my own personal journey, especially over the last 4 years. But I still am an organized, particular person. I mean, even me stepping back, it still makes people's heads spin sometimes. So I feel like a different person in a lot of ways. But anyways, yeah, I do love organization. I love for things to be efficient. And yeah.
That's great. No, the reason why I bring that up is because I hear you and see you mention that quality a lot. And it seems like you've embraced it pretty well. I mean, you seem to own it. Whereas I've never liked, I shouldn't say I've never liked who I am. I've never embraced it like you've embraced your qualities, you know? So that's encouraging for me at least.
Yeah. It's funny. It speaks to my personality, which is a little bit of just kind of like own it and go. I'm not a person who naturally wrestles with a lot of stuff. I just kind of, you know, it's like, which direction are we going? Let's go until further notice. And it doesn't mean that I'm not interested in kind of wrestling things down and understanding. But once I know, I usually lock in pretty quick. And I'm an all or nothing person. It's like polar opposite. So either I'm like not interested, like sports, not interested. Don't touch them. Barely know how to keep a conversation going from headlines and major players' names. And then like on personality assessments, I'm all in, I'm obsessive. So I don't really have a middle ground very much. And that's totally cool. It is.
Yeah, that's
it is.
Cool. I love that. The reason why, so welcome to my experiment, the Scott Townsend Show. This is like I mentioned earlier, this is a show. It's something I love to do anyway, but in looking for a job, I thought, you know, what I should do is create content and show people how I can create it, how I can market it, how I can promote it, and all these different skills and stuff like that. So I find that, you know, Zig Ziglar said, if you help enough people get what they want, you'll get what you want, or something like that. So I find myself,
that's right,
if I can, I find myself in promoting myself, if I can just promote enough other people, then that might work out in my favor. So
hey, there you go. Well, so we're promoting
Jesse Anderson here.
There you go. Well, at the same time, you're also showcasing your ability, which is, since I've known you, this is how we connected. And I'm trying to think of what year that would have been. I mean, it might have been 6 years ago, something like that. Does that sound right?
At least. It's got to be
something
longer
like that.
That.
But,
it's got to be
longer
than
was,
that. 8 years
but it
ago.
Was around, social media engagement. And I don't think that I knew about Gary Vaynerchuk except through you and the thank you economy at that time. Like, absolutely revolutionized the way I thought about customer service. Forget social media engagement, but just customer service. And I've always known you to be a purveyor of social media and technology, and always deft at figuring out what's the next thing that's coming. You know, it's funny, it was 2 weeks ago at church, there was a little QR code to scan. And I kid you not, I thought Scott Townsend was telling me about these. like 8 years ago, and he was telling me about how that it was on a garbage truck in New York, and these are going to be like the future. And you know, Microsoft had their tag
thing, right?
And I used one of those for one thing, but you always like QR code, man. I'm telling you, QR code. And you know, it's slowly made its way. Yeah. Slowly made its way in. And now it's crazy that I could just pull up the camera app on my iPhone, point it at that thing, and it pulls up. And so every time I see a QR code, I thought, Scott told me about QR codes before QR codes were QR codes.
Yeah, really. That's so funny. So let's talk about you. You've got a new podcast out, The Art of Understanding. I spent a lot of time last week running through your episodes, and man, you've got a good podcast going. It's typical Jesse Anderson. It's tight. It's efficient. It's got good information.
Thank you.
And I got to tell you, before this interview, I was really scared. I was nervous because you and I are so totally opposite. I was like, you know, he is the J and I'm the P. And and J's scare me because, you know, J's are like, there's got to be a deadline. You got to know your stuff. You got to get turned in on time. Whereas a perceiver such as myself, loosey-goosey, I mean, you know, come on, let's shuck and jive and let's handle, you know, last-minute problems. We'll deal with it when they come up. And so I was like, oh, man, this really has got
Well, you'll appreciate this. Just in my own personal journey, and I don't know what I could put a time frame on it, but maybe back to 12 months, I live more like a perceiver to me. But to other people, I'm still a hardline judger. But to me, I live internally the way I interact with the world almost more like a perceiver than a judger these days. And that's just, honestly, that's part of just kind of, even though I'm all about embracing your personality, I'm also interested in how do you understand it? And kind of next level for me is how do I hack some of those tendencies that are ruts or ditches or hangups? And how do I flip the other side and do something different just to kind of see a different perspective and kind of find the balance? I have a preference for judging. Like that's what I was born with. That's natural. You know, to me as a judger, I'm just trying to live like a perceiver as much as I can and try to be a little bit more open-handed and go with the flow. So you're in good company.
Good. Well, before we get too far into this, I should back up for anyone watching or listening. We're talking about Myers-Briggs. Jesse Anderson started the podcast Art of Understanding. He's a Myers-Briggs coach, consultant. And so this whole podcast that you've got going here is really centered around Myers-Briggs, how to understand it, how to use it. So tell me, this is your show. I'm just going to turn it over to you. So what's up with the podcast?
Yeah, so it's been 4 years now ago that I got certified as a Myers-Briggs coach. I mean, how many of us, especially in American business, have taken Myers-Briggs, know of it, maybe even can rattle off our four-letter type? But I went into that training with kind of a little bit of a chip on my shoulder towards Myers-Briggs because I thought, man, when people take this assessment, it feels like it's inaccurate. It feels fairly shallow, even though you read the couple of page profile on whatever site and you go, yeah, that sounds like me. I just think, what do we do with this information? And I went into this and probably my first indicator that this was deeper and kind of more extensive than I thought was that there was pre-homework to this thing. It was a four-day course and there was homework every night. I think we had five exams in those 4 days. And if you really wanted to be a fastidious, you know, dutiful, responsible student, probably about 2 hours worth of homework every night. Crazy, right? You know, like after an entire day of lecture and all that, and like, it's a ton of information. But what I found was that there was so much under the surface. I got answers to a lot of my questions in the first day. And after that, my mind was just blown and like, wow, this was like my first taste of psychology and kind of what personality theory can do when you're interacting with people and the lens that it gives you for other people. So the Art of Understanding had been something that idea, like I always knew I wanted to do something with personality training, whatever. I've done a couple of workshops here and there, but the Art of Understanding came to me probably last fall, last summer, something like that. I was talking with a friend and he designs logos and he needed to kind of dust off his skills. And so he wanted to design a logo and that came out of that. He was like, what would you call this? And the Art of Understanding came to me after our meeting and he designed this. So I'd sat out on that logo. And then in quarantine, I guess maybe that second week of quarantine, it just felt like launch now, this is the time. And so I started with the with the kind of under the assumption that I would post daily episodes for the first 2 or 3 weeks since we were in quarantine. People were just gobbling up content then. I mean, right. We were all trying to figure out what the heck was going on. We were just on our phones all day. So I did 7 episodes in the first 2 weeks. And then I was like, this is crazy. And what's so funny is, like, even though I am a judger, I was so freaked out to launch that podcast because I didn't know anything. And I decided I'm going to launch this thing on a Wednesday morning. And the following Monday, my first episode was live. So I knew nothing about gear and subscription service. And I mean, nothing. All I had was literally a logo and a head full of personality assessment knowledge. And so I launched this thing in 5 days. And last night I uploaded it, but today went live, episode 22.
Awesome.
You know, not just about 3.5 months later. So crazy. I've been pleased with the response. You know, I'm not trying to promote it or make it any sort of massive thing. Ultimately, the goal is to help people with just kind of bite-sized nuggets, how to take personality theory and make it practical and useful in your everyday life. And ultimately, I'm developing a course that people could take, a video course through Teachable, to be able to really understand their personality type, their spouse, their kids. You know, where I'm really passionate about personality theory and assessments and all of that is in marriage and parenting. I love it in the workplace. I love it for interpersonal relationships. It's all good. But where I want to see fruit from it is in your marriage and with your parenting. And that's a product of my own life and journey with Myers-Briggs. And not a day has gone by since that training 4 years ago that I don't utilize Myers-Briggs. Think about it. Every conversation I'm in, I'm filtering right. through those lenses, changing my communication to match the preferences of the person on the other side of me, and parent my kids different based on their types too. So yeah, I love think it. I'm obsessive.
The marital thing, I agree with you. You've got to have a serious sense of humor to survive marriage. You know, the marriage jokes are the best because everybody can relate, you know.
That's right.
I married my wife for her looks, but not for the ones she's been giving me lately, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
But you know, if you don't take the time to work and understand, and this really goes to the art of understanding, if you don't take the time to go understand the person, your spouse, your friend, your boss, your coworker, your children, you're at loggerheads with them a lot of the times because you're so one-dimensional with them.
Well, we're trying to approach other people on the basis of our own filters and value system and the way we see the world. And it doesn't really work that well because you got two people who are seeing through different lenses trying to come to agreement or try to connect. And so my whole thing that I'm passionate about is people understanding yourself, yes, but so that you have kind of a case study that you really understand. And then you can start to go, so I, as an ENTJ, an extrovert, intuitive thinker, judger, can start to understand, okay, what does that look like? What does not just that four-letter type, but what does each of those letters mean? And how is that different from my wife, who's an introvert, sensor, feeler, all opposite, and a judger? We connect on that. But how do I understand her better? Because she's seeing life through at the complete opposite end of the spectrum. So how do I learn about myself, use myself as the case study in order to change my approach and to try to get across what I'm trying to say or communicate to somebody through the lens that makes sense to them? I really want to communicate through their filters. I don't want to communicate through my filters. Because how many arguments have you been in your life, in the workplace, at home, with your kids, where you're just like, this is not working. We are not getting anywhere. And both of us are doubling down on our lenses, our approach, our things, and we're just going, you've got to be dense. How are you not hearing me? And personality assessment gives you a sort of, in my language, a cheat code. It's like a user manual for other people.
Right.
I don't natively understand my wife as an ISFJ. I'm just like, that's so foreign. Like, how do you live your life? It doesn't make sense. But as I get into personality, I go, okay, I can start to unwrap this. And then I see that with my kids too, because not only are they different, you know, between both of them, but I'm different than both of them in terms of just how we're wired up. And you'll appreciate this bit of trivia. This is how obsessive I am. I typed my son, meaning I know what his Myers-Briggs type is, at 13 months old. He wasn't walking or talking, and I already could tell what his type was. But it's been so helpful since he's been that now he's 3 and a half. And I treat him so much differently than his older sister. She's brash and out there and just wild. And, you know, when I understand that, I now speak through their filters in a way that hopefully increases the connection and the depth of relationship that we have.
And so that's really awesome for kids, because I remember growing up, for the most part, because people didn't know, it's just because they didn't know, we were all pretty much treated the same. I mean,
yeah.
I mean, everybody gets the same Christmas presents. Everybody gets, you know, the three brothers get the same treatment, the same, you know, it was just a survival mode for the parents.
That's,
you know?
Right. Yep.
And
yep.
They didn't know any better. And so I think there was a lot lost in the growing up process there. I was not into sports. My brother was into sports. Then I had another brother that kind of sort of wasn't in the middle somewhere. And all three couldn't be any more different. But because, yeah. I don't know, I think it's so valuable to appreciate the person for who they are and meet them on their terms instead of just pushing them through this cookie cutter process, you know?
Yeah. Well, and one of my biggest passions as a father, the way I like to say it, one of my goals is that my kids would leave the house with as few daddy issues as possible. You know, I've heard this from my counselor, which is the father plays such a crucial role for sons and daughters. It's not that the mom doesn't have a role, but usually you're not hearing a lot of counseling issues relate back to mommy issues. Now, you might have some of that tension. It's all good. But typically you're seeing a lot more on the dad side. And for me, knowing how I'm wired, man, I could crush my kids, especially like my son who's wired up, like my wife, very differently than me, if I'm not careful with that. So we do have a general standardized level of parenting, and then we have the nuances.
Right.
And they get different things from me. They get different facets of how I'm wired. And it's not that I'm myself, it's just that they get a version that really connects with their filters and lenses. And that's something I'm really passionate about. Is how did they get the best version of me, and how does our relationship, how does it be close even though they're so different? And because I'm a steamroller, man, you let me go just in my natural preferences and live in life, it's bad news. It's really bad news.
That's so funny. I think once you get to know yourself, it is funny, you know, because you look, it's almost like you're looking at yourself from the outside looking in, you know, going, oh my God,
yeah.
I really like that.
Yeah.
So let's back up also just a little bit and talk about, so I want to know what I am. So Myers-Briggs, I'm bought in. What's the best way to get an assessment done so that I can get the best diagnosis?
Yeah. So the one thing that I am against recommending to people is, hey, just search for a free online test. And that's just as accurate as can be. Typically people end up on 16personalities.com. I don't have a problem with the profiles that they have there, but the official Myers-Briggs indicator is what they call. They don't even call it an assessment, just an indicator. Which way do you lean? The official Myers-Briggs indicator is built to be forced choice, A or B, one or two. And so when you get into the sliding scale stuff, disagree, don't necessarily agree or disagree, agree, strongly agree, all that, it skews your results. And so, you know, there's an assessment that I sent you, which is from my favorite Myers-Briggs blog, psychologyjunkie.com. Susan Storm does amazing work. I don't know her, but I have read so much of her work. And there's so much garbage about Myers-Briggs online. So many different extrapolations and assumptions and just poor kind of extrapolation of such a deep and insightful framework. But Susan has just an amazing blog filled with tons of articles that I love. And then she's got an assessment that she built, which is kind of built from a certified coach's perspective. So that's a free one I'll send people. Officially, the way that Myers-Briggs would say, if you want to know your type, you connect with the coach. You have a conversation to get with that coach. And one of the key things that conversation entails is getting into the proper mindset before you take the indicator. Because so many of us, we roll into the indicator. And by the way, this is good to note for any assessment that you take, any personality. We roll into it thinking, I'm just going to answer based on how I act. The problem behaviors. The problem is Myers-Briggs is not trying to identify behaviors. It's trying to identify preferences. And those preferences can be different than our behaviors based on the environment that we're in. We don't get the opportunity as a father, a husband, a coworker, a boss, a son. We don't get the opportunity to live 100% in our preferences every day. So our behaviors are maybe different than what we would prefer. So that conversation with the coach really helps people to get in that mindset, what Myers-Briggs would call having a shoes off mindset. No husband shoes, dad shoes, boss shoes, worker shoes, you know, all of that. Like, take all those shoes off and think, what would I choose if I got to choose? That's where you're going to get the best results out of the indicator. And then the other part of the process for Myers-Briggs in the official way is to then have a follow-up with that coach and have a session where you walk through and hear a little bit more about, okay, what does extrovert and introvert actually mean? And then just a conversation to go, okay, did you agree with what the indicator indicated, what it came out with? It might have said, hey, you're an extrovert, but you hear about it and you go, okay, I hear that this, you know, I see that this said extrovert, but really with what you're talking about, introvert is really the preference for me. So there's kind of a reconciling after the indicator to be able to figure out what you are. You know, what I do in some of my workshops is I try to kind of combine those without going through the official indicator, but I try to do a lengthened coaching session on each of the dichotomies, extrovert, introvert, sensing, intuitive, and so forth, and help people understand, okay, which are you when you understand what the differences are, and then what's your spouse, what's your kids, all of that. But that's a really key thing, is having proper mindset, understanding, you know, what each of those mean. I got a text from a friend a few weeks ago, kind of a classic thing, which is, you know, my parents took this, this is what their assessment came back with the indicator. And it's like, you know, it does not seem accurate at all. And I'm like, yeah, that's why I went into my training going, what's this thing based on? You know, why is it inaccurate in that way? But thinking about preferences, thinking shoes off mindset, and getting with a coach to really understand what's the essence of each of these. Like, for instance, most people would assume that extrovert, introvert, we do what we naturally do, is apply stereotypes and say, well, if you're an extrovert like Scott, then you just like people and hanging out. And introverts, like, you know, your wife or whoever, don't like people and don't like hanging out. And that's not true. It's not black or white that way. The question is not, you know, to decide whether you're an extrovert or introvert. The question is not, do you like people and socializing? That's not the question. The underlying question to that is, where do you direct your energy, your attention, and where do you get your energy? I just did a podcast about that actually this week, episode 21, just talking about it, some simple misconceptions with that, because I hear a lot of people misunderstanding it. So that's a lot of words to that question. But, you know, I like ultimately getting with a coach, and Susan's assessment on Psychology Junkie is a great start to be able to understand, what am I? And then what does this actually mean? By the way, let me say one thing. So people misquote the percentages that they get, where like you might go through a 16 personalities and go, okay, I'm 73% extrovert, or I'm 52% introvert. That has nothing to do with the strength or intensity of that preference. So it's not to say, oh, he's a 98% extrovert. That means he's just way off the chart. Man, he loves people. He loves to talk. He's always loud. He's always loving socializing. No, no. What that percentage is indicating is how clearly and consistently you chose the extrovert preference when you were met with that forced choice. When you go back and forth, 98% of the time you chose extrovert over introvert. Mm. So if there was 100 questions, 98 of them were extrovert. If you're saying, well, I'm 63% introvert, then you chose 63 that were introvert, and you chose 37 that were extrovert. So it just has to do with the clear, how consistently and clearly you chose that, as opposed to like, wow, she's really an introvert, like, don't talk to her. It's not that at all. Right. That's a common misconception.
So looking at today and today's times, it's been a crazy year. You better have your seatbelt buckled if you're in 2020. There's what, 17 million people looking for work or whatever, you know, there at one point we were matching the Depression era, unemployment. Yeah. And, I'm right in there with a lot of them. And so how does knowing your personality type, how would that help you in your job search, or how would that, you know, knowing yourself better, how would that help you align with a job that you might be looking for? Does that make any sense?
Yeah, totally. I do think that that there can be a ditch to fall into, which is sort of like, you know, you're this type, so these are the jobs that you should focus on. And I don't necessarily see a direct correlation of like, hey, there's a handful of jobs for each type and you should try to chase after those. I think there's some ideal ones, but I do think when you look at not just the four letter type, but you start to think how you're wired, each of those letters individually, what kind of environment is going to be best for how I'm wired? Because here's the thing, if you're not operating and living out of your preferences as much as possible, it requires more energy. So great example, you're a perceiver. And just to clarify what the difference is between judgers and perceivers, this has nothing to do with the actual word. It's not that you're more perceptive and I'm judgmental. It's not that. Oh. It's how do you structure your external world? So judgers prefer a more planned approach, a more structured approach, a more organized and scheduled approach. They like having a plan. So like if I'm going to go on a vacation, in my natural preference, I don't like to just roll up and go, we've done no research. Let's just kind of walk the streets, see where there's a lot of people. What's a busy restaurant and go there. I'm like, no, you research it 6 months before and you check Yelp and you go, all right, we're going to go there Monday night. That's kind of the ideal. Right. Perceivers are going to be more loose and open to last minute changes and information. They don't like to have to make a decision when there's time on the clock.
Right.
Let me have as much time as possible to figure that out. So you as a perceiver, if you were getting into a very judger heavy organization or job, and most organizations are going to be judger, right? Because we've got a bottom line, like right. We've got to make money. We've got to meet our goals and objectives and KPIs and all that. But as a perceiver, if you were in a job that required you to just like deadline, plan, structure, no chance for any sort of dreaming or changing or whatever, but just like work the plan. Bad news. Could you do it? Yes. Would you be stressed? Would you be more tired? Would you be more frustrated? Absolutely. Because you're having to spend more energy. And so, you know, I don't necessarily know that I would go if you're an ENFP, oh, stay away from this type of job. But I would say understand where your kind of ideal contribution zone is. Where's your sweet spot? Where you can innovate and where you can dream and where you can think outside the box and where you can not have to be in a place that has a lot of rigidity, a lot of rules, a lot of routine. Those are things that I would suggest to avoid. At the same time, I'm not saying don't do this job, don't work for this company. You can kind of figure it out. You know, we were texted about this the other day, and I don't want to get too far into it, but just a teaser of a little series that I'm going to do on the Art of Understanding podcast soon. Is about an assessment called the thinking wavelength, which I think has more application to what type of job you get than even Myers-Briggs. Hmm. And when I learned about thinking wavelength through the Patterson Center and the Patterson process, STRADOP being for organizations, how do we help organizations find clarity and profile the business? And it's just an amazing strategic planning process. And then life plan, which is doing that for your life. And you see all of your life on charts and you're really finding out how you're wired and where's your ideal contribution zone. Thinking wavelength is a simple, simple assessment in that. And really what it is where are you on the scale of concrete to abstract thinking? And there's five different categories that really pertain to, you know, one side being more administrative, more operational, more concrete, the other side being more strategic and developmental. And there's a very simple 6 questions that you go through. I'll walk through all those through on the podcast and then break down each category. But like if you're a very entrepreneurial, more innovative, more willing to try new stuff, more willing to say, hey guys, we should use QR codes, and everybody's looking at you going, what the heck are QR codes? Then you should not get in a role which is more of an administrative, hey, this is how we do this. You know, like accounting would be a terrible role for somebody like that, because it's like, there is no dreaming. There right. is no major innovation. These are the generally accepted accounting principles. This is how we do stuff.
That's it.
We've got a due date. We've got audits to come. We've got all that. And at the same time, you wouldn't want to take a person who wants a little bit more structure and rules and routine. To be in a role where it's like, hey, would you, you know, figure out how to increase our awareness in the community? Now, to somebody higher on the thinking wavelength, great, you gave me all I need. I'm good. I'll go figure out what that looks like, and I'll have a blast doing it. To somebody more on the concrete, though, go, what does that look like to you? What steps am I supposed to be taking? This helped me so much in my marriage. Oh man, I'm going to talk about it on the podcast, because like this little assessment helped me so much, even beyond Myers-Briggs, because even though I can understand the type, it's just viewing from a different angle. I've talked about this on the podcast. You would have heard me mention it either in the video I sent you or the podcast, but I think of personality assessments, each showing an angle of a diamond. If you as a person are a diamond, each one shows a slightly different angle. It's all the same diamond, but it's showing different things. So StrengthsFinder and leading from your strengths and Myers-Briggs and right path and thinking wavelength and spiritual gifts and birth order and everything tells a different side of who you are, but it's the same side. So you can't just go, Myers-Briggs is the best and the only. It's like thinking wavelength totally revolutionized the way I think in the workplace, in my house, the way that I interact with my wife. We use this common language to be able to describe. It's again, it's alleviating another tension or miscommunication where it's like, why can't you fill in the blank, whatever that is. So anyways, long answer to that question, but I do think it's helpful to know kind of how you're wired up. And hopefully the more you know about yourself, the more strategic your questions can be about the role you're stepping into, and you can get to more clarity and understanding, you know, kind of like, hey, I like to be a little bit more loose with kind of a plan and approach. What's kind of the temperature of the organization here in terms of how that works, and what's the expectation for this role? How much is it where it's like, hey, you got to tell 6 weeks in advance what you're going to be working on and then work that plan? Or is there some flexibility? Is there some fluidity? Again, using the example of perceiver judger, those would be kind of conversations that I feel like are helpful questions to be asking in a vetting process.
Shifting gears just for a second here, and this will probably, we're past 30 minutes here. I appreciate your time.
Yeah.
There's a lot of stuff going on in the United States now where people getting along with each other is concerned. I know you've done some podcasts on listening and people listening to each other. I appreciate that. I'm glad you did that. I'm just really having a hard time with people not appreciating each other. You know, whether you're, there's so much racial tension, whether you're like me, American Indian, or you're German, or you're African American, or Japanese, or whatever, you know. When we were growing up, we were taught to appreciate, it's just like a spice rack. I mean, everybody brings a different, like you said, there's a multifaceted, everybody brings their strengths, and you should appreciate, the short, the tall, the round, the, you know, however you're made. We were made different to, so that we could appreciate. It's just like that one guy said on your podcast. Gosh, what was his name? I was just listening to it like literally 10 minutes before this interview.
Was it Sean from last night or from this morning, or Afaya?
It wasn't Afaya. It was one of the last ones. Sean, talking about how God made flowers and trees and, you know, all the flowers, they're different shapes or different colors or different smells or different.
Yeah.
And so that's the way we should be with each other. We should appreciate the differences and not be getting so wound up in the, I don't think people know how to listen. I don't think people know how to listen to each other.
Well, yeah. And I think, you know, a couple episodes I did that just, and it wasn't a very prescriptive or instructive episode. It was just me kind of openly musing about this, but this idea of listening to understand rather than respond. And, you know, Scott, one of the biggest things that I'm finding in my own life is one of the key things that has to be done is I have to slow down. And that doesn't even mean slow down in the conversation. Like I'm finding for me being type A and driven, like I have to slow the pace of my life down in order to be present in the moment with somebody and be able to listen. Because otherwise I'm firing off quick opinions and judgments, and it's not bad that we have those. I don't think it's bad that we all have a point of view and a perspective.
Right.
But I think what we're doing is it's like we're we're having a conversation where our faces are, you know, we're not looking at each other. We're talking past each other. It's not a conversation where we're looking straight in their face.
We're having monologues, not dialogues.
It's kind of a monologue, but we're like talking over each other's shoulders. And I'll say one of the frustrating things that I have is just it doesn't feel to me like we're in a very open-minded season. What I feel is in this moment on Facebook and in the news, and everything is polar opposites and we're shouting at each other, but we're not really stopping and going, wait a second, what did you just say? Okay, let me just take all of these ideas and opinions and everything, set them over here, suspend them, which takes time, real time. And then to be able to sit there and go, so tell me that again. What's your approach? Huh? And ask questions or just listen. You know, in the listening session, which is a mini series that I've started, today was episode part two with Sean Thomas. I started this last week, a series of conversations with African-American friends, just to give a window into the African-American experience and hopefully learn from their perspective and experience in order to take a step closer to empathy. Last week with Afaya and Brandy, Afaya was talking about this, the diamond example, and just going, so many times we're shouting at each other from either side of the diamond going, no, you got to see it from over here. This is what I'm trying to tell you. This is what's right. And we're just literally like looking around going, no, I'm telling you, it looks like this. And we're never stopping and going, you know what? I'm not going to do this. Let me just come on the other side and go, oh, that's interesting. It does actually look different over here. You should come on the other side and see it looks different over here too. Yeah. And then we can at least go, all right, we're looking at the same issue. We're just looking at it from two different lenses. So that's what I wish. That's the journey that I'm personally on, slowing down, having conversations, learning to empathize. And really what I would say is I'm kind of stepping out of the ruts that I either subconsciously or consciously have created in my life. So many subconscious ones, by the way, just culture, environment, where you grew up, all that. Stepping out of all that, setting everything aside and going, I'm going to listen to different voices. I'm not going to listen to the people who are in my stream and in my circles. I'm going to listen to other people and try to get more towards the middle. I'm not trying to swing the other way, but I am swinging hard personally right now to be able to get out of those ruts and ways of thinking, in the hopes that I would be able to see more in the middle. And by middle, I just mean that I could empathize and see from my perspective and somebody else's perspective. And assessments do help with that. It's a very simple way to do it. Obviously, the racial tension, inequality, injustice, reconciliation, conversations that we're inundated with right now, that's a much, 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 much deeper conversation that four letters cannot help with. but it does require slowing down and getting to that empathy, same heart and same desire to connect and see the same things.
When you talk about listening, I think of that scene in Jaws where Roy Scheider's on the beach and this lady's talking to him and he's trying to listen to her, but he's looking past her shoulder because he sees something in the water and he's trying to talk to her and he's not listening at all. You can tell he's totally preoccupied with what's going on in the water.
Hey, Mike, I know you got a lot of problems downtown, but I've got a couple of problems at the house I wish you could take care of.
One, I've got some cats parking in front of the house. I can't get down to the office, and that garbage truck next to the office has got to be moved.
So what I need is a red zone. It's a simple thing you can take care of.
Honey, would you come here a minute, please?
And I think that's a lot of what we do is we're so preoccupied with what's going on in our own world that we have a hard time listening to the person that's right in front of us. So if someone wanted more information, Jesse, about you, or they wanted assessment info, they want to get in touch with you, some coaching information, what's the best way to reach out?
Yeah, so the simplest way is just to email me at hello@theartofunderstanding.com. You can find The Art of Understanding on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and Spotify. You can follow me on Instagram at Jesse Anderson, J-E-S-S-E, Anderson, A-N-D-E-R-S-E-N, and then underscore at the end, at Jesse Anderson underscore. And in my bio, like on Instagram, or if you find me on Facebook, on Instagram specifically, you can find the link to the Art of Understanding profile. That's just at the art dot of understanding. Kind of annoying, but somebody already had at the Art of Understanding. So
we'll put a little link at the end of the video here so people can see it. So this interview will be posted on LinkedIn. So all of you on my LinkedIn network, if you have any questions, comments, leave them in the comments section below. Or you can reach out to Jesse on the email that he mentioned just a while ago. So for Jesse, this is Scott Townsend. Thanks for joining the Scott Townsend Show. And we'll talk to you later.
Scott Townsend Show is a Dietz Oman production. For more episodes, visit the Scott Townsend Show YouTube channel, listen on Apple Podcasts, or wherever you listen to your favorite shows.